I call this public hearing for the regarding the Powhatan District seat to order. We have 21-ish speaker cards. Normally we allot 30 minutes for these types of public hearings, but we're going to allow 2 minutes per speaker, which gets us to more than 30 minutes. But Dr. Beers.
It is at this point of our meeting where citizens are invited to address the board. Those citizens desiring to speak have submitted speaker cards to the clerk prior to the start of tonight's meeting. These speakers are asked to come to the podium when their names are called, state their names for the record, and direct their comments to the chair of the board. It is the board's interest and desire that all comments are heard and respected. Hence, the citizens are asked not to engage in applauding, verbal outbursts, or any other type of demonstrations during the presentation. Personal matters are not considered in public meetings. Therefore, the board requests that all speakers refrain from making reference to specific individuals in any form or fashion. Though the board does not respond to your comments are heard and appreciated. Each speaker is allocated 2 minutes to make their presentation, and the board asks that you respect this time limitation. Also, please be reminded that no time may be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My directions are concluded.
Thank you, Dr. Beers. I appreciate everybody's interest and participation in this process. We look forward to hearing from everyone. Ronnie has the time over there. The lights, when's the yellow come on? Do you know? So yellow come on when there's 30 seconds left, red. And in deference to the time of everybody here in attendance and the board, I'd appreciate stopping when the red light comes on. The first speaker tonight will be Elizabeth Elgert.
Good evening, Chairman Kelly, members of the school board, Dr. Constantino, and ladies and gentlemen. My name is Elizabeth Elgert. I have been an educator for 28 years, most of that time in Newport News Public Schools. I have been a Peninsula resident since 1995 and a Williamsburg resident since 2011. I have known Lisa Ownby since 2001. Ms. Ownby has a background in community activism and service, using her master's in social work to advocate for students with intellectual disabilities by directing programs through Presbyterian Home and Family Services, Catholic Charities of Richmond, Virginia, and Virginia Board of People with Disabilities in Richmond, Virginia. She has served as a board member for the Arc of Greater Williamsburg and the president of the Arc of Virginia. She has served on numerous state boards, including the State Rehabilitation Advisory Committee, a position she was appointed to by the governor. She clearly has a very strong background in community activism, advocacy, and public policy, along with broad experience in budget management, human resources, and program development. As impressive as all of this is, there are four much more important qualifications to keep in mind when considering Ms. Ownby's application to fill the vacancy. Their names are Marshall, Breyer, Oakley, and Townsend, her four children, one a college freshman and recent graduate of Lafayette High School, the other three currently enrolled in WJCC schools. She has had children at DJ Montague, Hornsby, and Lafayette, so as a parent, she sees school from all angles and will be able to share that perspective with the board. She is active in all three schools, doing everything from serving on the PTA boards to helping with a bake sale to organizing the band uniform booster club activities. She is passionate about education for all children, from the most abled to the most differently abled. Her background in advocacy and her present experience as a mom make her an ideal candidate to fill the vacant school board position. I was thrilled when I heard Lisa Ownby had stepped forward to fill the vacancy on the WJCC school board. She offers a wealth of experience in public policy and community service and an all grade level parent's perspective and a deep love for this community. I cannot offer a more passionate endorsement. Thank you.
Thank you. There was no yellow light.
I guess we adjusted the time.
Okay. So it goes from green to red. So there's a timer up there. Patty DeBlas.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Patty DeBlas. I am a candidate for the school board. As a parent of two daughters, one graduating from law school in the spring and the other a junior in college, I have served as a student activist and parent volunteer in numerous capacities in numerous school systems. I've also been a PTA treasurer and a substitute teacher. Along with my husband, I founded a nonprofit here in Williamsburg, Blooms That Brighten, which serves our aging population here in Williamsburg. Serves 13 continuing care facilities and hospice house. As a local business owner, a business I might add that's been around for 77 years, I get the experience of seeing on a daily basis the challenges of our economic times. Sometimes I need to make those decisions on an hourly basis, but that also comes with being a business owner. Our tough economy has predicted certain things for us, some of them more predictable than others. That presents many challenges for us as local economies. I do a lot of speaking in the community to a lot of different organizations, and one of the things that I always start my conversation with is thank you for the support. Without that support over the last 77 years, we would not have been able to survive. And as we all know, a thriving community starts in our school systems. Without that support from the community, the system does not work. That being said, we all know a well-managed school system increases our property values. That's important to all of us. We face some challenging times. Healthcare is a large challenge for us, as one of the many challenges that we have. The economic environment of that allows us to...
Thank you, Ms. DeBlas. If you could forward your comments to the board, I'd appreciate
that.
Thank you. Ms. Mary Miner.
Good evening, Dr. Constantino, Mr. Kelly, Ms. Cook, and members of the school board. My name is Mary Miner. I reside at 8314 Barron's Court in Williamsburg, and I am here tonight to talk about the interim position in Powhatan. Like many others in the community, I was really surprised when Mr. Fuentes resigned from the Williamsburg James City County School Board. With the election just 8 years before, four new members, it's an unanticipated challenge for the board. After some reflection on what the characteristics of the school board might want in an interim member, I came to the conclusion the board would consider several important characteristics. A member who was knowledgeable on public financing, school law and regulations, the strategic plan and planning process, as well as the dynamics among the board and between the board and the administration. An applicant who had no particular agenda seeking elected office to consider while serving as an interim member. Having served on the WJCC school board, who made an interim selection member, the willingness of the applicant to focus on student success and safety was a priority. Almost 20 years ago, I'm dating myself, I sought election to the Williamsburg James City County School Board. CARES was the acronym I used for my campaign, and it's because I believe communication, achievement, accountability, responsiveness, effective and efficient programming, and real solutions are necessary. My application is because I continue to care about the WJC students in this community. My three children attended throughout elementary and middle school and graduated from Lafayette High School. My objectives in applying for the interim position are to support the board as it develops the relationships among themselves and with the staff and community, to assist the board as it moves through a difficult annual budget process, and ensure that the improved communications between the community and among staff are there, and to support the superintendent and his administration as to meet the goals and objectives of the strategic plan. And I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to apply for this position and for your consideration.
Thank you, Ms. Meyer. Frank Abbott.
Good evening, all. I have a perfectly timed 3-minute speech that I'm now going to cut down to 2 minutes, so here we go. In the past couple years, again, my name is Frank Abbott. I live at 301 Parr Drive in the Powhatan District, and again, thank you for having this special session this evening. In the past couple years, I've become more involved with 4-H, which is the nonprofit youth organization, and their motto is to make the best better. My wife and I chose to live here 12 years ago because of the strength of the WJCC school system. And it's in that spirit that I'm volunteering my services to serve on the board in order to make the best better. What specifically can I offer? Well, one thing is after 22 years in the Army and 10 plus years in the corporate world, I've developed a lot of experience with strategic planning. I understand it can be difficult, especially when you have to figure out where you are and how you're going to measure your progress, but I offer that experience, and I think that could be beneficial. I enjoyed serving on the Career and Technical Education Advisory Committee from 2008 to 2013. That experience showed me how very important it was to have a strong program that offered alternatives to students who, for whatever reason, chose not to go to college immediately upon high school graduation. The importance of providing those students with skills and experience that employers are looking for, that just can't be underestimated. Another particular interest I have is talent management. For the past few years, as a consultant of the U.S. Army, I've been coming up with different ways to find the best and the brightest to not only soldiers, but government civilians. And I think some of those principles can also apply to the WJCC school system, since we're only as good as our teachers, our administrators, and our support staff. Thanks very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Abbott. Thank you for your service to our country, and be happy I didn't cut you down to a minute 20. Jody Dulcey. Did I come close to getting that right?
Good evening. My name is Jody Dulcey. I have two children in our school system. My daughter is Celia is in sixth grade at Berkeley, and my daughter Karina is in second at Rawls Bird. And I have had the great pleasure of knowing and working and volunteering with Jillian Dalton, one of your candidates, and I'd like to wholeheartedly endorse her. During my time with Jill, I've come to realize that she never commits to a project without understanding the complexity of all that it entails, and commits to it when she feels that she can make it better, and then she does. I've watched her take two struggling preschools that really had really low staff morale and high teacher turnover rates, and turn them into high quality programs where teacher retention rates were amazing, and they were committed to the program, and they understood it, and the children were happy, and the parents were happy. She has taken on roles in the PTA and at her son's preschool that nobody else wants, and then wholeheartedly, detail-orientedly commits to those and turns them into some of the most successful events that bring in highest grossing funds for the programs. And she does it all very stealthily and unassumingly. It's great to see how she so gently pulls people into the projects and gets them excited and understanding how wonderful the adventure really is to work together to create excellence. So if you're looking for a candidate who understands how to balance real evidence and guidelines with the heart and needs of families, then look no further than Jillian Dalton. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Happy Troy?
Hi, good evening, everybody. My name is Cappy Troy. I'm a parent of two kids who attend Claire Bird Baker Elementary. And we all live together at 4805 Bristol Circle in West Stray Downs. I'm here this evening with a perfectly timed 30-second speech that I'm going to try to stretch out into 2 minutes. So I'd like to say a few words on behalf of Jill again and her interest in seeking the interim position here for the board. Jill and I met about 6 years ago as new elementary school parents. We sent our girls off together to kindergarten. And we were anxious and hopeful for a great experience for them. They became fast friends. And over the last 6 years, I've gotten to know Jill as a very thoughtful, engaging, positively involved parent and member of this WJCC school community. I've also kind of, as I've thought back about how I know Jill, I look to her a lot for her opinions and insight on a lot of the issues that we find ourselves concerned about in our school system. I feel like she has already kind of positioned herself as a natural leader who has a very calm presence and is always offering responses that are fair, solution-based, and always in the best interest of our students and our kids. I absolutely trust Jill to represent the interests of my family and my kids, the most important people in my life, and I know that she represents them in a positive way. She'd make an excellent member to the school board and has my enthusiastic endorsement. I can't think of a better endorsement than from another mother and someone who's equally as passionate about her kids receiving a great education. So thank you for your time. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mrs. Troy. Dorsey Orlowski.
Good evening, members of the school board and Dr. Constantino. My name is Dorsey Orlowski, and I am here to voice my support for Lisa Ombe to fill the open position on your board. I met Lisa Ombe about 10 years ago. My family had moved to Williamsburg about 6 months prior, and my oldest child was in preschool getting ready to move up to kindergarten at DJ Montague. I was introduced to Lisa, who was the PTA president at DJ at the time. We learned that we lived in the same neighborhood, both had daughters starting kindergarten in the fall, and also had another child, my second and her fourth, which were close in age. But the thing that stuck out the most about meeting Lisa this first time was her enthusiasm, her knowledge, and her passion for DJ Montague and for WJCC schools as a whole. As I've gotten to learn more about Lisa over the years, I have seen how truly knowledgeable, passionate, and dedicated she is to education in our community. When my youngest was having some developmental delays and was finishing up her time at CDR, Lisa helped me understand that what the need center was and what a tremendous resource that was. She helped me understand what an IEP was, what that process was, and what WJCC schools could do for my daughter and what resources we provided at the school level with different therapists and so forth. She's a tremendous advocate for all students at all levels and for all needs. She's volunteered countless hours by filling various board positions and committee assignments on PTAs at the elementary, middle, and high school level, as well as serving on PTA council, as PTA Council and as school band boosters, as well as working with various educational advocacy groups. I don't have much time left, so I will just say she's awesome, so thank you very much.
Thank you for that summation. Lisa Lucas.
Good evening, members of the WJCC School Board and Dr. Constantino. My name is Lisa Lucas. I live at 103 Mearfield in the Powhatan District. And I support Lisa Ombe for the Powhatan seat on the WJCC School Board. Thank you for the opportunity to share my comments with you this evening. I've been fortunate to serve with my friend Lisa Ombe in a number of volunteer capacities in WJCC schools at DJ Montague Elementary School, Lois Hornsby Middle School, and Lafayette High School. I've witnessed firsthand her positive leadership and community engagement in WJCC, her advocacy for an in-depth knowledge of educational institutions and learning for all students and all abilities, her steadfast support of teachers and administrators in our district. If you examine Lisa's extensive resume, you will note that she has demonstrated for over 25 years a commitment to education through her professional experience and volunteerism. She's tirelessly worked on behalf of the disabled and disadvantaged at the local, state, and federal level. Her passion for education, practical experience in budget and institutional management and proven commitment to our community would be a tremendous asset to our WJCC school board. I'm very proud to be her friend, and I hope you'll consider her candidacy, her being a part of this. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Lucas. Lizzie Bailey.
Hello, my name is Lizzie Bailey, and I am here this evening to speak on Jillian Dalton's behalf. I am a resident of Williamsburg, James City County, a local high school teacher, and Jillian's friend. I have known Jill since 2010 and can speak to her love of children, to her commitment to our community, and to her desire to see our children and our community continue to grow and thrive. As her friend, and I can attest to her strong devotion to her own children and to the children of our Williamsburg, James City County community. One example of this is her work at the Bayplex Martial Arts Center. There, she has served as camp director and future leaders club counselor. She helps our young people to discover and to develop their own leadership skills, and she nurtures them as they grow into confident, capable leaders. Many of the adolescents who participate in activities at the Bayplex Center are students of mine, and they always speak highly of Jill and the programs that she runs there. She is also an assistant troop leader with the Colonial Coast Girl Scouts. Through her work there, she is helping to educate our next generation of young female leaders about the importance of community involvement and improvement. Another example of her devotion to our community is her work on several parent-teacher organizations over the years. She has had to communicate effectively and efficiently with different groups of parents, teachers, administrators, business owners, and community members. She has successfully worked to build relationships between different stakeholder groups within our community to the benefit of our children and our schools. She is knowledgeable about how to further develop these relationships to keep improving and enriching our schools and our community. Jillian brings valuable experience and viewpoints to the table. She has worked as an educator and an administrator. She is a parent and a local business owner.
Rats.
She's great.
If you could forward your comments to Ms. Sirza, and she'll pass them to us. So. Jillian Dalton.
Hello, I'm Jillian Dalton. I would love to be considered for the interim school board position with the Powhatan District. I'm a graduate of our school system. I went to Matthew Whaley, Bruton Heights, James Blair, and Lafayette. I currently have a kindergartner at DJ Montague and a fifth grader that I homeschool. As a former preschool teacher and private school administrator, I feel that I'm able to balance the evidence and guidelines with the heart and needs of the students and faculty in our schools. I would love to continue to move our school system forward in excellence. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Dalton. Lisa Owenby.
Good evening, school board members and Dr. Constantino. I'm here this evening to introduce myself to those of you who don't know who I am, and to share with you that I feel strongly compelled to serve on the school board and would be honored to work with each of you, and would like to thank you for considering me for this interim position. I'm deeply committed to public education and always have been. I do have a vested interest and the success of WJCC schools. As Beth Elgert mentioned, I have four children. My oldest graduated from Lafayette last May and is just beginning his second semester at Ferrum College, where he plans to be a PE teacher and hopes to come back and take Mr. Fields' job. He said he's going to wait until he retires.
Yeah, does Mr. Fields know that?
That's his plan. My youngest is currently a fourth grader at DJ. My middle child is a sixth grader at Hornsby, and my daughter is a freshman at Lafayette. I have an historical perspective. I've lived here about 25 years. My children have been in WJCC schools since 2002. When I came here, we had one high school. And in those 25 years, we have grown a lot and expanded and built buildings, and it's exciting. And I look forward to continued growth and success, but think that my history can be relevant to board deliberation and discussion. Moreover, my experience in public policy, and education, advocacy as it relates to disability rights and educational issues, along with my work on PTA Council, various PTAs, PTSAs, human resources, and higher education at William & Mary, I think would benefit and could contribute to the activities and the responsibilities of the school board. I will thoughtfully examine issues that are brought forth to the school board. I will work tirelessly to ensure positive outcomes for our division's children, students, families, teachers, and administrators. I'm eager to represent the Powhatan School District. Obviously, I live in Powhatan, but we'll work for the entire school division. Thanks so much.
Chelsea Goldstein.
Hi, good evening. My name is Chelsea Goldstein. I have two children in the WJCC district. I have a son who's a freshman at Lafayette and a son who is an eighth grader at Hornsby. I've known Lisa Ownby for about 5 years, and during that time we've worked together on many projects from the classroom level to the annual PTA events. In recent years, I've had the pleasure of working with Lisa on the Lois S. Hornsby Band Boosters Board. I've come to know Lisa as a doer, a team player, and a very dedicated board member. Under her leadership, many of the challenges of previous years have been removed and our processes have been streamlined. Lisa is a fantastic planner and has successfully organized our volunteers, both parent and community, developed fundraising projects, and planned our major events for the entire year. She has a great rapport with our administration, teachers, students, and parents, as well as the local community. I believe Lisa would make a very strong addition to the school board, and I plan to provide a letter to that effect shortly.
Thank you. Susie Yates.
Good evening, Chairman Kelly, members of the school board, and Dr. Constantino. My name is Susie Yates. I'm a Powhatan District resident, and I'm here this evening to show my support for Lisa Ownby to serve as interim school board member for the Powhatan District. Lisa has a depth of experience working with agencies dedicated to children's issues, varied work experience in both the public and private sector, and as a committed volunteer in the WJCC school system. As a resident of James City County for 25 years, she and her husband Matt have, have made a home here with their four children who are either attending or have attended WJCC schools. Many of us have children in the school system. But her efforts extend beyond her own, and her loyalty to WJCC schools is evident. I am supporting Lisa because I would like to see how she can contribute her experiences, insights, and understanding of public policy to work toward continuous improvement of those efforts already established, as well as those strategic goals that lie ahead. Again, I support Lisa Ownby as WJCC interim school board member for the Powhatan District, and I thank you for this consideration.
Thank you. I have Roseanne Redden, but I think you want the regular meeting, right? Yeah. That's that pile. Lisa McCoplin? What's that? McCulpin. You're the first one I've butchered tonight, so I'm pretty, happy with that.
That name gets butchered quite easily, so. Good evening, everybody. My name is Lisa McCulpin, and I have a child here in the school district. He is an eighth grader at Hornsby Middle School, and I am here to give my full support to Lisa Ownby for the interim position of the school board. I've known Lisa, I'm going to say going on maybe 5 or so years. I met Lisa when we came to DJ, when we had the redistricting. And I've worked with her on various PTA projects during those times. But this year, I've actually had the pleasure of working with her more closely as part of the band boosters for Hornsby. And I guess in short terms, I always want to say she's a dynamo. She gets things done. She wants to get it done. She can get it done quickly, efficiently. There's planning. There's no wishy-washy stuff of anything. She gets things done. And that's the key thing I think that's part of for what this position is for. And listening to the other speak this evening, I've heard extensive resume, and it's very impressionable, her advocacy for children and all that she offers. So again, I'm just giving my aspect of it, of working with her on one-on-one, and I just feel that Lisa would be a wonderful asset to the school board. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. McColpin. Jerry Farrell.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jerry Farrell. I'm here tonight representing the Williamsburg-James City County Education Association as their secretary. We just would like to let everyone know that we're thrilled about the amount of people who want to come out and support our public schools. So many candidates are willing to come forward. We would just like to say that we hope you select someone with strong connections to our school and experience with a position similar to this in this time of budget. We wish you the well as you consider this important matter. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Farrell. Michael Loy, this meeting or the? Okay. Thank you. I wasn't sure if you gave me a card if it was this meeting or the next meeting.
I wasn't sure either, sir, so I just checked every box.
That's an option.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Superintendent Constantino. My name is Michael Loy. I reside at 123 Lakewood Drive in the Berkeley District, but I'm here in support of Ms. Jillian Dalton for the Powhatan District. I want to take a moment to praise the turnout of individuals who have stepped forward to be considered for the Powhatan seat that has been vacated by Mr. Fuentes. I'm certain that all that have come forward are worthy of consideration, and we have heard high praise from many members of the community as well as some of those running for this position this evening. However, I would ask that as you weigh the candidates and their abilities, that you look at those that may be a direct representative of the constituency that they would represent. For example, I have children currently in school. I think that's been checked. Have been active in their schools through PTA, volunteering, and activities. Check. Have an open mind as we consider significant changes to the district, future leadership, policy change, and growth. And be a conscious and consistent advocate for students and teachers. I believe that Jillian Breslow Dalton brings these and many other qualities to the table and, for what it's worth, would be an amazing addition to this board. A daughter of a lifetime educator that was held in the highest regard during his 40-plus years of service here with WJCC schools, she comes from remarkable stock. I'm certain this selection will be a different one because of the caliber, a difficult one, because of the caliber of candidates. However, if I were to be in a position to choose a candidate myself, Jill would be that person. She has my highest recommendation, and would be an immediate contributor to the board and WJCC schools. Thank you for your time, sir.
Thank you. David Daffichet.
Evening, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. Thank you for this opportunity to introduce myself to you all. I am one of the candidates for the position, and I'm a native of Williamsburg. I grew up here, attended both Williamsburg, James City County, and York County schools. My mother was a teacher here at Williamsburg, James City for over 40 years, and my father is also in academics, having taught at William & Mary for over 50 years. So I come from a fairly deeply rooted academic family, and education is something that's always been very, very important to us. And my wife, Mary Angela, and I have a 2-year-old daughter, Elizabeth, and it's really been our greatest pleasure after many years away to be able to move back to this community, you know, in the hopes that I can raise my child in the same enriching, wonderful environment that I had the opportunity to grow up and start my life in. I am passionate about the Williamsburg area on so many levels. It transcends just the school system, but certainly that is, I think, one of the true gems and feathers in the cap of this wonderful area that we call home. And I would be absolutely thrilled to be a member of this this board. I think I have a very critical mind. I can keep an open mind, and I enjoy being a listener. I can't check off all the boxes probably that some of the other candidates can, in the sense that I'm in a profession that's a bit outside perhaps what is typical for a candidate. But I think I bring a freshness and an open-mindedness and a willingness to be a team player. And I think that's part of my strength, and I would love nothing more to be a member. I know you guys are going to do outstanding work with or without me, but I would love the opportunity to be a member to help this grade system get even better. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Dorothy Osborne.
Members. My name is Dorothy Osborne, and I am here to speak on behalf of Lisa Ownby. I've known Lisa Ownby for 7 years, both as a colleague and a friend. I've had the privilege of working with her professionally as an apparent on the Lafayette High School PTSA. I was very pleased to hear that she was interested in serving. As a parent of 3 children in the WJCC schools and one that just graduated, I would very much like to see a person like Lisa serving on the board. There are many reasons why I feel she would be a good fit. Her degree in social work, her work with special needs children, her policy and advocacy involvement all make her well-rounded and a well-informed citizen and a potential board member. She is knowledgeable about local, state, national, and global education issues, and if you read her very long resume, you'll see that she has experience with federal, state, and local agencies, grants, budgets, policy, law, and regulations. Lisa is someone who is a good team player, and by that I mean she is open-minded, and someone who has the ability to engage in give and take discussions in order to arrive at a group consensus. As a board member, she would listen to anyone who communicates with the board, and she would seek to understand their points of view, but recognize that she has to represent the interests of the WJCC community as a whole. She has the willingness to spend the time required to become informed about issues and problems and to do the homework required to be effective in school board meetings. She's not the sort of person who would base her decisions solely on her own experiences. In every encounter I've had with her, she has completed her own research and provided informative feedback, even if it was not her personal opinion or viewpoint. She can have open discussions without bias, a quality that I often find hard to find in my personal experiences. She will encourage free expression of her fellow board members and will honor differences of opinion or perspective. Her work and her service in WJCC schools shows that she clearly has the desire to serve children and her community, and she has a strong belief in the values of public schools. She's not an axe carrier or crusader. She understands and is committed to the educational mission.
Thank you. Raina Graham Montague. Hoping I didn't mess that up too bad. Oh, thank you.
Pardon the scrubs. Good evening, Dr. Constantino, Chairman Kelly, and school board members of Williamsburg James City County. I'm Raina Graham Montague. I'm a local pediatric dentist and business owner, and I'm here to support Ms. Jillian Dalton. I live on Horns Lake Road in Governor's Land in James City County, and I'm here to speak on behalf of Ms. Dalton. She should be selected. You're a school board candidate because she's a fresh face that knows the current concerns of parents and children in James City County and would work tirelessly to improve those concerns and to help the school board. Other reasons are that she's a mother, which you've heard, with grade school children. She's also an educator, an administrator, a small business owner, and she's altruistic. I think that's the best thing that I love about Jill is that there's no political motive. She wants to purely serve the community and improve the quality of life and education for families without praise or recognition. She's one of the most humble women that I've ever met. We met 9 years ago when Ms. Dalton was the director of the Goddard School. It's a private school when I lived in the Richmond area. She was entrusted with the care of an entire private school and assisted with the education of my daughter throughout private kindergarten. She believes in family involvement and has demonstrated this by her involvement in our local schools, Claire Burt Baker, DJ Montague, and the United Methodist Preschool. Her focus is the best education for the future of our community. With an education and administrative background, she would be able to transition easily onto the school board for the remaining term. She's easy to work with and easy to talk to, with the utmost respect for people of all walks of life. When we arrived to Williamsburg and I discovered that she managed the Bayplex Martial Arts program, I was extremely comfortable with transitioning my daughter, who's at Matoka, and being transported over to the Bayplex program. Ms. Dalton is a community advocate and activist, and with the ultimate goal of serving the community and providing quality education for our children, I'm here to endorse Ms. Jillian Dalton as a beyond superb candidate for the school board position.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Lisa Thomas.
Good evening. I'm Lisa Thomas. I reside in the Powhatan District, and I've graduated two children from Lafayette High School and currently have a senior at Lafayette High School, and I'm here this evening to speak on behalf of Lisa Ownby. I've known Lisa over the last 20 years in a variety of capacities, as a professional colleague, as a parent receiving services, and as a community advocate and volunteer. Lisa came to work at CDR in 1996 as the federal project director for a respite training grant for families of children with special needs. She made it clear that not only did she see the need and the value for this support, but she also offered a unique perspective as a family member of a brother with significant developmental disabilities. Her knowledge of special education and community supports for those children is unparalleled, and it'll bring a very important dimension to this body. However, that's not her sole credential or her focus. As you've heard, she's an active and highly engaged parent of four children, all who attend the Williamsburg-James City County School System, and she's served in a variety of capacities. She's experienced the school system from every perspective, from preschool on up to grade 12, from special education to general education to PTA to athletics to fine arts. So she's seen every perspective, and her passion and advocacy for those high-quality educational services would be a tremendous asset to this board. She seems to me, at least, tireless in this pursuit while balancing the demands of her husband's business and her children's activities. And as you've heard before, she's highly organized and can get the job done. She's worked as a consultant with the College of William & Mary, and she has experience as a businesswoman, a volunteer, and an all-around interesting and supportive person. So I think that you'll find working with Lisa will be a very good experience, and perhaps you'll learn something. Thanks.
Thank you, Mrs. Thomas. That's all the cards I have, unless one's stuck together and somebody didn't get identified. Good. I just want to thank all the speakers who came out tonight on behalf of the candidates and spoke for us. The members of the county school board certainly have a difficult decision. I also want to thank the citizens who stepped out there to seek this appointment. That's a very difficult decision. We have all made that decision. We know how tough that can be, and I appreciate that. I appreciate the quality of the citizens who stepped up, and this can be a thankless job, but it can also be very rewarding. So I appreciate that. A little bit about process. We'll be taking letters of recommendation for the next week or more. We will have interviews for the candidates on the 12th of February. We've scheduled, I think, most if not all of those by now, and the four members of the county will deliberate. The city representatives have the option to sit in on those interviews, but before deliberations, the city representatives will depart and the county representatives will make the decision. So beyond that, after we make the appointment, there will be a special election in November for all seekers to finish out the balance of the term, which is through November of 17, or just through December of 17. In November of 17, you have the opportunity to run for a two-year seat and to take you through December of 19. So a little bit about process. With that, we're adjourned from the public hearing. And then I will immediately call the meeting of the school board to order. I guess I should double tap that. Can I get a motion for certification of closed session?
Mr. Chair, I certify to the best of each member's knowledge the Williamsburg-James City County School Board, while in closed session, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements as stated in Virginia law, and that only such public matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Thank you. Is there a second? Okay. Thank you. So moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? We moved and seconded for the certification of closed session. Ms. Serza?
Dr. Beers.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. Ms. Serza, can you take the roll, please?
Dr. Beers.
Aye.
Oh, it's here.
Here.
Ms. Cook.
Here.
Ms. Hummel.
Here.
Mrs. Taylor.
Here.
Mrs. Young.
Here.
Mr. Kelly.
Here. Folks at the beginning of the alphabet have to pay more attention than the rest of us. Motion for approval of the agenda.
Mr. Chair, I move approval of the agenda, the remainder of the agenda as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Moved and second for approval of the agenda. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Hummel.
Aye. You're right.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Dr. Beers.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. 6.01, announcement superintendent's report. Dr. Constantino.
Here.
Oh.
Good evening, everyone. As everyone is well aware, we missed 3 instructional days recently due to inclement weather. I'd like to thank all of the employees who helped get us back into schools, because without their extra efforts, our calendar disruption could have been much longer. To help our families and communities have a greater understanding of the intricate process that happens when inclement weather is upon us, we have posted information on our website. Please look under More News on the homepage and follow the link to the inclement weather information. And to answer the question that I'm sure is on everyone's mind, currently February 15th is still a holiday. If we miss more time in the next week or so, we will have to take a look at that. But Punxsutawney Phil has given me great hope that that's not going to happen. So President's Day remains a day in which schools and offices have a holiday. I'd also like to congratulate the SHIP program for another successful Chef's Challenge. Chefs from the Blue Talon, Windsor Mead, the Williamsburg Inn, Colonial Williamsburg Apprentice Program, Camp Perry, and the Waypoint Seafood Grill worked with child nutrition staff to create new entree recipes for our school lunch menu during this event. 9 teams competed, and congratulations to the team of Chef Kylie Kidder from the Colonial Williamsburg Chef Apprenticeship for helping to create the winning dishes, buffalo chicken, mac and cheese, and a 3-bean salad wrap. Second place went to Chef Scott Hoyland from Blue Talon Bistro and his team for the spicy chicken cheesesteak, and third was awarded to Chef Oriana McGee from Windsor Mead and her team for the chicken Zen wrap. I also want to thank the SHIP program for allowing me to be a guest judge again. It's always a good day of tasting wonderful food, and also want to thank Dr. Beers for joining us that day as well. Those are all the announcements that I have, Mr. Kelly.
Great. Any announcements from any board members? I would like to add, Dr. Constantino, the thanks for the operations staff and many others who were involved in the snow, making the calls to close and getting us back open again. I would also like to thank all those students who tweeted you pictures of glaciers and penguins and other snow banks that I didn't realize existed in James City County, but I'm sure they wouldn't try to couch your opinion any other way. I think it was Pound Believe in the Steve, I think as well. 7.01, recognitions.
Mr. Chair, tonight we'd like to take a moment to express our appreciation for our community's school board. February is School Board Appreciation Month in Virginia, and it's a good time to thank school board members for their critical role they play in our schools and communities. In recognition of your commitment to the students and families of the WJCC Public Schools, Please come forward as your name is called and remain, please, for a group photo. First, Mr. Kelly, chair of the school board. Kira Cook, vice chairman. Dr. James Beers, parliamentarian. Julie Hummel. Ali Taylor. Sandra Young. Please also join me in congratulating School Board Clerk Janet Serza. The Virginia School Board Association Board of Directors has designated the third week in February as VSBA School Board Clerk Appreciation Week. This week is designed to build awareness of the role board clerks play in assisting members. And if Janet would also join us to come up front and be recognized. Chair, that concludes recognitions.
Thank you, Dr. Constantino. That brings us to 8.01, citizens' comments. Dr. Beers?
Once again, it is at this point in our meeting where citizens are invited to address the board. Those citizens desiring to speak have submitted speaker cards to the clerk prior to the start of today's meeting. These speakers are asked to come to the podium when their names are called, state their names for the record, and direct your comments to the chair of the board. It is the board's interest and desire that all comments are heard and respected. Hence, the citizens are asked to not engage in applauding, verbal outbursts, or any other type of demonstrations during the presentations. Personnel matters are not considered in public meetings. Therefore, the board requests that all speakers refrain from making reference to specific individuals in any form or fashion. Though the board does not respond to your comments are heard and appreciated. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes.
3 minutes.
To make their presentation, and the board asks that you respect this time limitation. Also, please be reminded that no time may be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My directions.
Thank you, Dr. Beers. Mrs. Cook.
Jay Everson.
Thank you very much. Jay Everson, 103 Branscombe Boulevard in the Berkeley District. Mr. Chairman, Dr. Constantino, it's interesting that tonight that you've been looking at replacement for a person who has retired from the board. And I noticed that we now have 5 out of 7 who are in their first year. And I know it must be probably trying times for the chair, the vice chair, and Dr. Constantino, because these 5 haven't got a history. They may not know why certain decisions were made. If you recall back a few years ago, we went to open the 4th middle school, which would be Lois Hornsby Middle School. And lo and behold, there wasn't enough children to go in that, so the central office moved to James Blair. consolidated, got rid of rentals, good idea. But at the time they did this, it was the intention to have the annex be a magnet school, if you will, to offer additional programming for children at the time was for the all program. We have talked about maybe the IB program or the STEM program. But what's happened here is that the central office personnel at the time were no longer with us. They retired, they moved on. Dr. Matthews and I guess it was Dr. Lindsay and Dr. Chantry and I can't think of the others, but anyway, they moved on. But the intention always was to do that. And when we talk about a STEM school, it's a great idea. But if you have a whole school like that and you're going to have to redistrict, I mean, people are going to be kind of, is this going to be open? Is this going to be an open enrollment for people? It might be a great idea to start the STEM program to make sure it's successful, make sure there's enough kids who want to go there and go there by choice, and you would not have to have any divisive redistricting and save yourselves about $30 million in capital cost. Thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you.
Chris Henderson.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Constantino, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Chris Henderson, and I reside at 101 Keystone in the Jamestown District, and I am not an applicant for the school board, but I do appreciate the work that you do on our behalf. As I reflect on the comments that were made earlier in the proceedings this evening, it struck me that we're trying to replace a very key individual on the board. Mr. Fuentes served a very critical role and was perhaps of a unique perspective given his professional credentials and background as an engineer. I think it's critically important that there be a diversity of opinion and perspectives on a board because I believe that decisions are best made when various perspectives are represented. As I look at the composition of the board today, I notice that primarily amongst the board today, we have educators, and I think that's wonderful because we are in the business of education. But at the same time, I believe that there are unique perspectives that can be brought to bear and should be considered by those in the business community who have perhaps a different perspective on education and how it fits into the fabric of our community. So with that, I would offer you my great encouragement that you might consider diversity of opinion and perspective as you make a selection for your board. Tonight, I am here to speak to you again about my continuing concerns regarding the fourth middle school. I believe that the current James Blair site is too small to accommodate the needed facilities, specifically the ball fields, parking, ingress, and egress. The proposed facility is too expensive and will require construction of a new administrative building at a time when taxpayers can least afford it. Given the recently projected shortfall in state support for K-12 education and the still-to-be-determined makeup charges to the Virginia retirement system, tough decisions must be made now to prevent drastic cuts in services in the future. The current trajectory of spending by the Williamsburg-James City County schools is not sustainable, and the sooner that this body comes to grips with that reality, the sooner we can begin to implement solutions that meet the needs of students and protect taxpayers. Thankfully, enrollment has not grown as quickly as projected, and I'm told that student enrollment is down 35 students this year at Berkeley. I've never understood why this body has not adopted spot rezoning to alleviate overcrowding at specific schools and would urge you to do so. But with this added time to breathe, we should stop the work at James Blair and look for alternative sites that better meet the needs of students. Good sites within the PSA are available, and I identified several for your consideration about 18 months ago. Sadly, serious consideration was not given to any alternative other than James Blair. I think it's important that the school administration remain where they are for the time being, and we just need to stop wasting time and money on that current James Blair site. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Henderson.
Apologies for my inability to read this particular card. Mr. or Ms. Henry? Okay, thank you. John Magda.
Good evening, all. Mr. Kelly.
Thank you.
Board, Dr. Constantino.
John Magda, 2903 Richard Pace, over in the Berkeley District. A couple of things that popped up just this evening. We had some candidates running for a vacant seat to be filled. I see that the gross of them got up and left. I thought they would be interested in the school board. Just an observation with that. Thank you. Additionally, at the Board of Supervisors, we have a Pledge of Allegiance by the students. We're a school board. We should maybe bring a student to talk and give us a Pledge of Allegiance. I miss that. I'm here. We're all here, and I can't understand why we wouldn't do that. About 20-some years ago, I did not have children. I moved to the county. It was a wonderful little time, great county. I worked in Norfolk, but I liked the community. Let's see. Then I had a dog. I'll tie this in. So with that dog, I had a puppy, and we had to teach the puppy. So how do I do it? I went and got a book, and I read a little bit, talked to others, and we educated the dog. And the dog was a happy dog. It was a charming dog. It did tricks. It did what dogs do. Well, about 9 years ago, I had my first daughter, and I didn't know what to do. So I went out and I relied on others. About 5 years ago, we enrolled her in school, and I counted on others to make this happen. So far, the school system has had some very interesting challenges. So with that, things change. But what stays the same is that we continue to learn, continue to grow, and invest in the children where it should be. Enough of the dog. Okay, so on the way home, I work in the Beltway because it's a great job. It's a federal servant without a raise for how many years? I think we got 1% this year. Okay, how much is that? It's a civil service job, but what does it really pay? Nowhere near what it should, okay? The county, we have been in a pay freeze for 5 years for our teachers. They make $500 a month less than they did years ago. And during the same time, Dr. Constantino has received multiple raises, one in June of last year when his position as superintendent was as he resigned, and then he was rehired with a pay raise.
Thank you, Mr. Magda.
Thank you for your time.
Sandra Magda.
Good evening, Board, Mr. Kelly. I want to speak to you about what's happened with our family after we found out our oldest daughter was being bullied at school. At first, we told her to ignore it. We told her to stay away from the student. Then one day she came home from school crying, and we sat there and made one of many mistakes. We promised our daughter things would change. Our 8-year-old daughter stood there and looked at us and said, "It doesn't matter what you do, I will always be worthless." Those are not words our daughter learned in our home. And those words changed the course of our life for the last coming close to 12 months. Our daughter was being targeted on a daily basis from this student. She stopped eating, and in a 2-week period, lost 4 pounds. She started begging us to not send her to school. She no longer wanted to play the piano or do family activities. She was 8. And as many of you know her personally, you know this is not the child we sent to school every morning and in the beginning of September. People listen to our story and they think we are angry. But unless you have lived it, you'll never fully understand what it's like to stay up nights worrying, checking on your child, spending your days concerned as you send her to school where she is supposed to be safe, because every day she talks about how worthless she is and how the world would be better if she did not exist. She talked about self-harm. This continued on a daily basis for our daughter for 3 months. We went to the super, not super, I'm sorry, Dr. Constantino. We went to the administration at her school. We have recorded 67 emails of correspondence. We were promised a safety plan. And on the day that that safety plan was to be in effect, 9 days later, our daughter was physically assaulted by this student. And here we are, $10,000 tuition bill, attorney fees. We've lost count of our co-pays, and our daughter has changed forever. Your responsibility as a school board is to protect the children. Many of you were copied on many emails and no resolution for our child. I just want things to change.
Thank you, Ms. Megan.
Roseanne Redden.
Take a minute to reflect on that. How sad. Good evening, everyone. My name is Roseanne Redden. I live in the Stonehouse District. I'm a retired teacher of 35 plus years from public and private schools, from elementary to college. And I come here tonight to vote against the proposed newly reconditioned named James Blair Middle School project, which needs a lot more current research before we spend $61 million, and probably more because there will be a lot of little additions as we go along if it does take place. When I first heard about the project, I felt it was not a good plan in the first place because of the location. I think it's very dangerous. It's not large enough, I found out later. Now there's a supermarket going to be across the street. There's traffic there that I'm in all the time that I find really terrible. And when you add the school children and the parents coming and going, it's just very, very unsafe. There are other suggestions that have been made by members of the public to the board, and I think that they should be listened to. The options can be accomplished more quickly to accommodate what middle school growth could occur here, if we need it. I live in Colonial Heritage. Did you know that Colonial Heritage was put on that list of students who will be coming from Colonial Heritage? No, they won't. It's a 55-plus retirement community. We don't send children to the school. So that's a mistake already, which skewed the numbers of students that would be going into the school. Enrollment reports were inaccurate, and they should be corrected before this plan goes forward. You can always step back. Just a few hundred students off, if this repurpose was approved, will cost the taxpayers big time, and I really think that you should think about the project more before going ahead with it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Joe Swanenberg.
Good evening, school board members. Joseph Swanenberg, 3026 The Point Drive. You know, this first time in here for the school board, spent a lot of time in here with the Board of Supervisors. One of the things that really came to my attention is that people put their trust in the elected officials and assume that they are acting in their best interest. Ladies and gentlemen of the school board, please tell me how many of the actual school buildings have educated students in WJCC. I've been told that our school system has the highest cost per student of any school system on the peninsula, but furthermore, that we are the only system that doesn't have our buildings included in that cost. That's a very interesting statistic, if it is indeed correct. The thought, the idea, the plan to repurpose James Blair is a financial disaster. Number one, projected enrollment numbers don't appear to substantiate the needs. Better, more accurate numbers that are needed to take into account the retirement nature of our area, as well as specific retirement communities. Number two, if a middle school is actually needed, the size of James Blair is far too restrictive. Number three, the location of James Blair is very poor. We've already heard some issues on that, parking, traffic, a multitude of other reasons, but here we have the schools in the city. 80% of the students come from James City County. Number four, the total cost of the project, let's be realistic here, not the $60 million that's getting thrown around, $83 million. The public can't hear that number enough, $83 million. That's a shameful number. Number five, this is a one-of-a-kind school design tried in one other location in this country with no legitimate data or results on which we can base any real judgments. This is an experiment with taxpayer money on our children. That's what it is. It's an experiment. That's horrifying. Now, there's issues with the FY 2017 budget. $2.55 million. That's 3% of $83 million. We're whining about $2.55 million when James Blair is going to be $83 million. What world do we live in when we're crying about $2.5 million? Please, do the right thing for the public, for the citizens of the county who place their trust in you. Thank you.
Oh, that's okay. And any other comment? That brings us to 9.01, approval of minutes from the January 5th, 2016 meeting. Can I have a motion, please?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of the minutes from the January 5th, 2016 meeting.
Is there a second? It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the minutes from the January 5th, 2016 meeting. Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 9.02, personnel actions. Can I have a motion for approval of the personnel actions as presented this evening?
Mr. Chair, agenda item 9.02, personnel actions as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded for approval of personnel actions. Is there any discussion? It's moved and seconded for approval of the personnel actions. Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 9.03, Program of Studies 2016-2018. Can I have a motion for approval of the Program of Studies 2016-2018?
Chair, I move approval of agenda item 9.03, Program of Studies 2016-2018.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? There was some discussion last meeting about what the kids in the schools call a push.
Yes, good evening. Mr. Kelly, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. I'm here to make a little clarification. I think there was some misunderstanding about one of the courses that we're planning to separate. In the Program of Studies, we are going to be separating Honors English 11 and AP US History. They're going to be standalone courses. They're not being eliminated. I believe many of you misunderstood or saw that there's another course that has AP US History, but it is the AP English Language and Composition course that's paired with AP US History that has traditionally been scheduled together, offered at the same block on the AB schedule, which means that students on one day have the AP language, on the next day the AP history. And that will be continued to be offered. That is the course that has the very high enrollment, very, very popular with all of our students. So that course is continued to be paired, all three high schools. It's the Honors English 11 and AP US History, which has had the low enrollment as a pairing, will be separated to give students more options. If they choose to take one of those courses and not the other, they can still do so.
Gotcha. That helps clarify. Thank you very much. Any other questions from board members? It's been moved and seconded to approve the Program of Studies 2016-2018. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. That brings us to 10.01, Superintendent's Proposed Fiscal Year 2017 Budget. Before we get started, as a member of the School Board of Williamsburg-James-City County, I acknowledge that I have an interest in the fiscal year 2017 school budget because my wife is an employee of WJCC Schools. However, I believe that I am able to participate in the consideration of and vote on the budget fairly and in the public interest.
And yes, Mr. Chair, as a member of the School Board of Williamsburg-James-City County, I acknowledge that I have an interest in the fiscal year 2017 school budget because I am an employee of the Williamsburg Health Foundation. However, I believe that I'm able to participate in the consideration of and vote on the budget fairly and in the interest of the public.
Thank you, Mrs. Cook. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Chair and members of the board. Tonight, I have the responsibility to present the superintendent's proposed budget to the school board. By law, this proposal must be balanced with revenue that equals expenditure. The purpose of tonight's presentation is to introduce you to the proposal. We do not expect responses this evening as we understand your need to review and process the information you'll receive. In future meetings, we'll bring in-depth information on certain aspects of the budget proposal to inform your thinking and decision-making. As I go through this presentation, our Chief Financial Officer, Christina Berta, we'll be sharing slides that provide additional detail. For the past several years, we have faced shortfalls that have led to staffing reductions and program curtailments or eliminations. Even though our budget situation in fiscal 2016 was not as severe as the few years before it, we still cannot say that the school division has cleared financial obstacles created not only by the recession, but also due to the increased enrollment and diverse learning needs of our student population. State revenues continue to be a challenge. Every 2 years, rebenchmarking by the state adjusts the amount allocated to school divisions for the standards of quality, and also adjustments are calculated for the local composite index, or LCI. WJCC is forecast to receive $375,012 less in state revenue in FY 2017. While the governor is proposing additional funding to support instructional positions within the division, the acceptance of this funding requires a local match, thus resulting in no net gain. It is also very important to note that in the governor's proposed budget, state revenues continue to lag behind pre-recession 2009 levels by approximately $216,000, excluding inflation. I'm going to ask Ms. Burden now to explain the operating revenue summary chart.
Thank you. Just to give you a perspective about where our revenue streams come from, the majority of our funding comes from our local governing bodies to the tune of 64.7%. State allocates SOQ and incentive funding almost 25%. State sales tax is deemed local dollars here in our community, and state sales tax makes up 10.13% of our budget. Other revenues make up 0.65% of our budget, and things that fall into that category of other revenue are athletic fees, student fees, building rentals, summer school tuition. Those are the type of things that fall into those categories.
The division strategic plan is the guiding document for this proposed budget. Our focus is quite simple. The key to continued academic success is ensuring that we attract and retain a quality workforce, and that we meet the learning needs of students through engaging and customized learning opportunities. These priorities were evident in your feedback to us at the January retreat. Tonight's budget recommendation reflects a similar balance as in years past, expanding programs where student achievement data warrants the support, maintaining present class size ratios, supporting a quality workforce, and meeting the priorities of the school board and strategic plan while reducing and redirecting budget expenditures to efficiently use resources. The budget I'm proposing to you tonight totals $128,296,495, which represents a 3.2% increase over fiscal 2016. In order to keep the increase at this level, I am proposing a reduction in our operating budget of $2,142,585. Additionally, I am proposing local funding increase of $3.6 million or 4.8%, 4.5% if you factor out an increase in sales tax. Later in this presentation, I'll review those proposed reductions. The administration appreciates the board's guidance through the priorities that were set at your January budget retreat. As you recall, each need presented to you at the retreat had previously been reviewed and determined to support the outcomes of the strategic plan. I think it's prudent to begin tonight's discussion with what is not in the proposed budget. It became clear at the retreat that funding all that was prioritized is simply not possible. Therefore, the administration culled the priority lists, and as a result, I want to take a minute to highlight for you those priorities that are not reflected in this proposal that you might recall from the January meeting. Reductions in priorities that are not included in the budget are two additional assistant principals to support Towanda and Hornsby Middle School, the restoration of funding for student AP exams, high school and middle school science textbooks, the full expansion of personalized learning resources for middle school. We will adopt, hopefully, a slower distribution plan, and 9 replacement buses. Continuing that list, the restoration of funding for 2 preschool teachers, 2 preschool teacher assistants, 1 preschool bus driver, and 1 preschool bus assistant has been altered and modified to 1 teacher and 1 teaching assistant. Request for 3 student support teachers has been modified to 2 student support teachers. Our school division continues to grow. The projected student enrollment for FY 2017 is 11,433 students, which is 130 students more than FY 2016. This will require the addition of 5 teaching positions at a cost of $375,000. And it's important to note that our projections show continued enrollment increases for the foreseeable future. Maintaining a quality workforce is essential to all of the other goals and objectives we have for division improvements. I want to thank the Williamsburg-James City County Education Association for their help and their perspective on issues facing the division. We are in agreement that regardless of the issues, supporting our employees to the best of our ability has to be a primary focus of this budget. And as a result, the majority of our budget increases are related to staffing and compensation. One challenge facing the school division is an increase from 14.06% to 14.66% in the VRS employer rate, creating a mandated increased cost of approximately $715,000. It was very clear at the board's budget retreat that employee compensation is a priority. This budget is based on a new teacher compensation scale that removes all of the compression caused by the recession, raises starting teacher salaries to improve our competitiveness with regional school divisions, and allows for increases for all division employees. The cost of this is $2,444,217. At our next meeting, we will share the exact scale and specifics of the compensation proposal. We were very pleased to recently learn that the division's health insurance cost increase is projected to be 2% rather than the double-digit increase we experienced this fiscal year. This projection does not include implementation of any of the recommendations of the Health Insurance Task Force. However, at the board's next meeting, the task force report and administrative recommendations for further reductions to health care costs will be presented. Due primarily to attrition savings associated with retirements and projected staff turnover, we anticipate a budget reduction of approximately $1.5 million. We have also completed a 5-year analysis of fuel costs, have reduced those line items by a total of $250,000. When combined with efficiencies and delaying the bus replacement cycle by 1 year, these adjustments provide expenditure decreases of approximately $2.1 million. This offset allows us to move closer to funding the established priorities of the school board and strategic plan. We are recommending the addition of one special education preschool teacher and one special education preschool teaching assistant to remain in compliance with laws and regulations governing special needs students. Additionally, two learning lab teachers are requested to provide accessibility to students, with the majority of this cost being offset by the current supplemental pay budget. We're also proposing one technology technician to support continued expansion of division technology, and two operations and maintenance positions to begin to move toward the preventative maintenance plan recommended in the recent facilities study. Three additional bus drivers and two bus assistants are also proposed. The budget proposal recommends continuing with the division's technology refresh plan and the continuation of the personalized learning laptop program at the middle school, albeit slower than what was presented at the retreat. Continuing to move forward is critical to meeting the personalized learning goals of the strategic plan. The proposed budget also adds one ESL teacher to respond to the growing needs of our English language learner population. The proposed recommended budget seeks no additional leadership or administrative positions in the school division. The positions included in this budget include reading and math support positions, the restoration of one general education preschool teacher and one preschool teaching assistant, one additional special education teacher, and four special education teaching assistants to support caseloads due to increased enrollment and an increase in high needs students. Our vision statement guides us to pursue excellence and champion the success of all students through a strategic plan that allows for the fundamental changes in education and supports a school division that meets the personalized learning needs of students. We have also clearly prioritized doing all we can to support our workforce and to support needed certifications and expertise. This budget, while not meeting every priority that you identified, keeps the division moving in a positive direction, reinstates and includes efforts to support students in need, and keeps us focused on what is most important for all of our students to be successful. I appreciate your support and dedication to our students as we move through this process. Our CFO, Ms. Berta, will now provide you with a wrap-up of the superintendent's proposed operating budget.
Thank you. Just to recap, our enrollment this year was 11,303 students. We are projecting an increase of 130 students to 11,433. The FTEs included in your budget and the proposed budget take us to an increase of 32 full-time equivalents. The operating budget requested is an increase of $4,037,339, or 3.3%. And our per pupil cost is projected under this proposed budget to increase by $213.85 to $10,859.54. Just to show you a little bit about where we do our spending, the majority of our spending does occur in the instructional category, which is where it should be. Just as a little side note, the state has tossed around the idea of making it a requirement that school divisions spend at least 65% of their budget in this category. So we are above that, which is a good thing if that becomes reality. And you can see the other areas are very small in comparison to our instruction. Taking a snapshot about where we spend, we are people oriented. We spend 86.93% of our budget on staff. Purchase services is an area where we do our contracts, our technology licensure pieces. Other charges are utilities, graduation expenses, and insurance. Materials and supplies are instructional materials, fuel, textbooks, software. Tuition payments are to the New Horizons Regional Center. And capital equipment is any vehicle purchases, technology, laptops, those type of things. So then we take a snapshot. Everything that has been discussed to this point is our operating budget. We do have several other fund budgets. Our grant budget is from the federal government and state governments that provide us additional grants for our title grants and our special ed grants. We are projecting an increase of $146,055, or 2.8%. State operated fund is where we house Merrimack and Eastern State. We are projecting an increase in that funding of $21,447, or 2%. And of course, our child nutrition services is projecting an increase of 11,286, or just 0.28%. So our grand total of all of our fund budgets is projected with an increase of $4.2 million, or 3.1%. And that concludes our presentation.
Thank you. Are there any initial comments from board members?
I have a question.
Young.
My question is, we have the duty to establish a budget, and we have a deadline. What I'd like to know is, have we talked to the Board of Supervisors about the monies that will be available from the county?
We, meaning the administration, I've had general conversations with the county administrator about funding, but I don't have a number to give you. I have not been given, I don't know a number of what is available or what is not available. Generally speaking, though, I talked to the county administrator just today about the presentation that we would be making. So I guess the answer to your question is, yes, we've discussed it, but no, I don't know that number.
Other comments, questions from board members?
I guess I have one.
Mrs. Hummel?
On the FY 2017 proposed operating budget, where you're talking about enrollment percentage increase and then FTE percentage increase. So you've got an enrollment change of 1.2%. So you've got 130 new students coming in, a change of 1.2%, and then the FTE is, though, 0.8% higher. And I just was wondering, in a world where you would think those percentages would be somewhat the same, what accounts for the extra FTE?
I think the biggest piece is we're trying to catch up from where things have been cut in previous years. So the majority of our requests are to restore or to address needs in the division based on what we're seeing with our student population. So you are correct that you would normally be tit for tat, but with the reductions that we've had over the course of the last 7 years and trying to maintain positions with increased growth, in that period of time since 2009, we've experienced 800 additional students. So we've had additional increase in our students, and we haven't kept up with staffing that way consistently.
So if I were to look at 2014, 2015, 2016, I would have seen an enrollment increase, but the FTE would have been lower than that?
That I can't answer for you standing at this podium. I wasn't here at that time, but that's certainly something we can look at.
Any other board member comments at this time? Ms. Cook?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I look forward to reading this, and I'm certain I will be in touch.
Dr. Constantino.
Just one thing. I know that this is a lot of information, and you have a lot of reading to do. We are prepared to bring two presentations to you at the next board meeting, but as you think of questions or think of things that you'd like to know, it would be helpful for you to let us know at any time so that we can be prepared as quickly as possible, because we know we have a two-month window, and I want to avoid coming to the dais, getting a question, not having the answer. So if you think of things, please let us know.
Mrs. Cook?
To build on that, Dr. Constantino, I just want to thank you for providing this presentation to us earlier than you originally planned to, and thank you to your staff. Thank you, Ms. Berta, because it's going to give us the opportunity to have a more robust discussion with each other and with the community and with our funding partners. So I'm really grateful for that and looking forward to those discussions.
Thank you. Any other comments from board members? I would like to add to agree with Mrs. Cook about bringing this to us earlier. There's a lot to digest in here. The non-replacement buses, those are replacing of existing buses. Those aren't capital increases, because capital increases in buses is capital. Replacing old buses is operating expenses.
Correct.
And we're comfortable that those nine buses that we're not replacing, we're safe and we're okay with that, as best as Mr. Snipes can be, I'm sure. Good news on the health insurance. I like the 2% number versus the 8% number that we were talking about before. disappointed. We talk about attrition savings because that means we're having experienced teachers leave us and replacing them with young teachers, which on some hands is good and on other hands is not. No administrative positions that we're increasing. Somewhat concerning because our administration is very lean when we compare ourselves certainly to others. That is a big need that I think that we have. There's some things we could do with increases in communication staff and others that I think would serve us well. But there's a lot in here to look at. I appreciate the information that's being provided. And as we go forward and review and look and educate, there will be much community discussion coming forward and much discussion amongst board members. So with that, here. Dr. Constantino.
I just want to go back to your comment about buses where you said we felt comfortable. I don't want to give you the impression that we feel comfortable with that. We will bring forward at the next meeting the smooth replacement plan and what skipping a year will do to that plan, because it will once again put us behind in terms of bus replacement. Right. We've made that decision, and so we'll make sure we have the replacement plan.
I have the numbers if you want me to share tonight. There's 14 buses that come due for replacement in fiscal year 17. However, in fiscal year 18, there are none. So we feel like we are comfortable enough delaying it. However, that's going to push the ball down the road as we continue the smooth replacement plan in future years.
So we would actually have to replace them in 15 or in 18 that are 1 year older than they needed to be.
Right.
Gotcha.
Mr. Chair, thank you. Did we not recently submit a grant to purchase buses?
We've submitted a grant to get a rebate back on those buses. We did not get selected for that grant.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And brings us to 11.01, board members' comments. Any board members have any comments this evening?
Yes, sir.
Ms. Young?
I brought up the subject last time about block scheduling. I just would like to know more about it, and as there is a committee that is examining block scheduling in the school division, would it be possible to have a member or members of that committee come and report about the issues and concerns regarding block scheduling, the benefits, and also the downside of it? It's a request.
Short answer is yes, and I'll let Ms. DiPaolo talk to you for a second.
Evening again. I just want to give you a quick update on the high school scheduling task force. Back in October, we began to assemble a task force comprised of teachers, cross-section of high school teachers from all content areas. We have school administrators, content coordinators, special education specialists, human resources, and senior leaderships. We started the process. We've met three times so far, scheduled to meet more times, but we had a weather event, of course. We're evaluating the pros and cons of our current 4x4 AB hybrid schedule, as well as comparing it to a traditional 7-period schedule and other options. We have several points for consideration. We're looking at the time per course, curriculum delivery models, looking at project-based learning, STEM, STEAM, number of choices available to our students, course load for students and teachers, ability to double up on courses for credit recovery and acceleration. We're looking at the professional development needs that we may have for changing our schedule, looking at curriculum map revisions in case we have a schedule change, and the cost. So we're scheduled to meet again in February. Prior to that, we're going to be touching base with our students to get their input as well. We were supposed to do that in January, but once again, we were twice delayed because of two different weather events. But we'd like to talk to our students, convene again, and take a very detailed look at our current 4x4 AB hybrid and the 7-period day schedule, look at the pros and cons, then have a comparison and also bring it to our public, our parents, for some of their input.
Thank you, Mr. Paul. I didn't expect you to be up there. How's that for efficient service?
That is efficient. Appreciate it.
Any other board member comments? Dr. Beers?
Yeah, just a couple. I also very much enjoyed the shift challenge and being a judge. And I must say, I never realized how many different kinds of wraps you could construct. And my favorite did win because I'm very big on variety of color and presentation, and so I very much appreciated that. And all the hard work. A young man sitting next to me is a senior here and plans to go on to culinary school. And I asked him if he ever had an opportunity to go back into the cafeteria, spend some time. And he stopped and thought that no, he hadn't. But that might not have been a bad thing to do with somebody who's interested in going into the culinary arts. So I just sort of passed that along. And obviously I'm concerned about the budget constraints. But one of the things that and from my own experience, one of the things when William and Mary went through some rather severe budget cuts over a number of years, one of the areas that got severely cut, and maybe we need to look at that, was travel. And I know faculty fussed about it, and accommodations were made because part of the career of a faculty member is to make presentations, to be on panels, and it's not just going to be in your backyard, it's going to be in other parts of the country. A number of them did as well as they could, but it was a challenge. I haven't had a chance to, because this is the first time I've seen this particular budget, add up the total number of dollars that we spend or that we propose for travel. But I do think it would be something worth looking at and seeing if there's any way to reduce that or reallocate or however. I know it's a painful thing because you want teachers to go to conferences, you want principals to go, but I would like. I think that's an area that could be looked at. Okay, that's all.
Any other comments from board members? Mrs. Hummel?
I just wanted to add that I went to the New Horizons Butler Road campus, and for any of you that don't know, we have this great New Horizons facility that we have at our disposal, and it offers all sorts of wonderful career tech kind of opportunities for students in multiple school divisions around the area. And I just wanted to make sure that everyone knows about it, but also so that we can kind of investigate why, for example, York County has three times as many students that go through this center than WJCC, and I just want there to be maybe more attention paid to this area of opportunity for the students in WJCC, and I'd like to look into that a little more. So,
okay.
Thanks.
Anything else, board members? Dr. Beers, I appreciate your comments on travel. In my professional life as a licensed professional engineer, first thing that we always cut is training, and that's something that we really got to really do that with diligence, because that's professional development is what really helps us to get through these rough times. I'd like to go back and mention I appreciate all the interest in the Powhatan district seat, the speakers that came out tonight, the seven that have stepped forward to take the seat. It shows the interest this community has in our schools, the concern that they have in our schools, and also the appreciation they have in their schools. So I think that's a good sign. We will be traveling to Richmond on February 10th to meet with our legislators, Senator Norman, Senator Miller, Delegate Pogge, and Delegate Mason. Have agreed to meet with us up there, and I look forward to spending time with them and letting us be able to discuss the needs of public education in Williamsburg, Jamison County, as well as across the state. I think that's all I have this evening. Upcoming meetings, February 10th and February 11th, VSBA training in Richmond. for the Capitol Conference, as well as orientation for chair and vice chair and new board members. On February 12th, the county board members will meet to conduct interviews for the Powhatan district seat. On February 16th, we'll have closed session here at 6 p.m. In the work session room in the county in Building F. And then at 6:30, we'll have our regular meeting where we will say the Pledge of Allegiance. On March 1st, we'll have a closed session here at County F at 6 o'clock, and a public hearing on the budget at 6:30, and immediately following that, we will have a work session, our regular work session, and all of that occurs here in Building F. So with that, I think we're done for the evening, and I appreciate everyone staying with us, and the good work of the administration and the board to help us with this budget. We have many more weeks to go on it. So with that, we are adjourned.